गुड मॉर्निंग टुडे वी विल टॉक अबाउट ए स्पेशल टॉपिक इज कॉल्ड रिसेंट एडवांस इन बोन ट्यूमर एंड आई थिंक दिस टॉपिक और बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट विल हेल्प बोथ फॉर अंडर ग्रेजुएट स्टूडेंट एंड फॉर पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट स्टूडेंट फॉर अंडर ग्रेजुएट स्टूडेंट दे विल जस्ट लर्न अबाउट द अप्रोच ऑफ स्मॉल ट्यूमर and you have to know the protocol and for postgraduate student they have to know everything along with this basic topic so we can start first of all our orthopedic surgery has been already specialized from general surgery after times been started we used to do special operation like arthroplasty arthroscopy hand surgery deformity correction, pediatric orthopedics. But our bread and butter is trauma. Maximum orthopedic surgeon 80-70% cases deal with trauma or fracture patient. But along with this trauma, we have to deal with such special surgery. And only 1-2% of cases also we can found malignant or benign bone tumor. Benign bone tumor is most commonly found in the pediatric age group. Still, the chances of malignant bone tumor is very high in both for pediatric age group and for old age. And metastasis and myeloma patient also we can get in old age group. So, musculoskeletal oncology become a subspecialty in orthopedic surgery. Now, for every musculoskeletal oncology has some basic principle. First we have to go diagnosis. For diagnosis we have to take a proper history, clinical examination and documentation of all findings along with first investigation should be an x-ray. Then we should go for MRI. MRI means magnetic resonant imaging. With contrast, without contrast. If we are thinking about a malignant disease, we must do that MRI. Which bone is affected, then that bone full length MRI is mandatory for diagnosis and to know the soft tissue involvement and to know the neurovascular status along with the extent of the tumor. So MRI is very important for staging. Now along with this basic investigation, you have to keep in mind first investigation is x-ray. From x-ray we can get many information like where the bone loss, where the bone doing extra articular involvement or extra osseous involvement, soft tissue shadow, calcification, zone of transmission, periosteal reaction, joint involvement or not, marrow involvement or not, pathological fracture is not. Maximum information we can get from the normal x-ray only. After that, when we have to go for MRI. Why MRI? Because we have to know the boundary of the edema, neurovascular structure, periosteal reaction update, osseous involvement, skin metastasis, we have to know. So MRI is our best investigation for navigation of the tumor around the whole lesion, and it will guide us for approach, any type of approach, even for going to definite treatment. We must have a histological diagnosis. Without any histological diagnosis, no intervention is recommended in musculoskeletal oncology. Most commonly, we used to get some pathological fracture. And pathological fracture, we should not approach like a normal fracture. Because when we are getting or dealing with a case of pathological fracture, that pathological fracture may occur from different and site of involvement. And sometimes, and if we fix the pathological factor without knowing the pathology or without investigation properly, it can cause a devastating problem. I will show it later. Not only we jeopardize the tumor margin, along with we can endanger the life of the patient, because it can cause metastasis and whole massive inflaring of the disease. Now, for the diagnosis, we used to do open biopsy. 2 to 3 words regarding the biopsy. Biopsy must be done in a specialized center, and the surgeon who will perform biopsy, he should know about the future planning of that patient. And after taking multidisciplinary team approach and decision, we have to confirm the treatment protocol. Then only we have to put our needle or any knife to the patient. Otherwise, that can cause a massive problem, because if we go through this tumor from different side, then that site will be contaminated. Like if we go through by the side of neurovascular bundle or through a good muscle. So during, if this biopsy come turn into malignant bone tumor or any type of malignancy, then we have to sacrifice that muscle, or we have to sacrifice this big portion of the flap. So the plastic coverage as well as the free margin will be very difficult to get. So the biopsy is very small operation, but very important step and final step to reach the histological diagnosis. Regarding biopsy, we can do core needle biopsy. What is core needle biopsy? Core needle biopsy is wide gauge needle with a stylet, and we can take from 3 to 5 cores from the tumor. And we can, if we are dealing with axial skeletal, like pelvis, shoulder girdle, we can do this biopsy under CM guidance, and we properly hit that area and we'll put the biopsy. This biopsy can be done under local anesthesia in case of limb, but in case of pelvis, we can do it under small sedation or daycare. So no need to do long procedure, invasive procedure, and very minimum scar, and that is less morbidity. And we can do it in OPD basis also. Very minimum tissue contamination is helps for in further limb salvage surgery, and it helps in tumor resection. And deep tissue like pelvis and spine must be done under CT scan guidance. Just want to elaborate a small things. Suppose this was a case of giant cell tumor, and we have done an open biopsy. See the consequences of open biopsy. And but if during the open biopsy there is a massive bleeding as well as contamination of whole area, so we should not do open biopsy if it is not indicated. And for needle biopsy, see, only 2 to 3 millimeter incision only, and we can take biopsy sample and culture sensitivity also. And during our final limb salvage surgery, we can ellipse out that scar easily, and the specimen will be covered by healthy margin. So core needle biopsy is explained. Now staging. Recent advancement of radiology can nicely mapped out that tumor extent and character of the tumor before biopsy. PET CT scan is an emerging investigation which is very superior than the bone scan, and it has less height effect and detect metastasis or residual bone activity. Suppose one patient suffering from a bone tumor. Now we have done any operation, or or after any operation that patient come with a recurrence. Now is a recurrence or any psychological effect, we can judge it by the PET scan. This PET scan based on 18 FDG PET scan means radioactive glucose has been used fried, and all the bone, all the malignant tumor used to use glucose only, like fetus and brain, and that will uptake by our scan. This is called PET CT scan, and along with this PET CT scan, angiography is also helpful for highly vascular tumor, or we can locate the feeding vessel of the tumor. Now I am showing one small example. Without knowing the histology, one gentleman came with a shaft humerus fracture, and someone put a plate. Now see, the tumor going to increase. Now after angiography, this seen huge mass, and the limb has been sacrificed with total humerus processes. So before going to put any intervention or plate, any nail or plate or any things, you have to know the diagnosis of this fracture. I will show how we judge a pathological fracture from a normal fracture. Now regarding the treatment protocol, there are many advancements in our bone tumor treatment protocol, because in the old age the bone tumor was not too much interested topic. Now every person has very cautious about the treatment protocol and some medical aspect also. So no one need a second surgery or repeated surgery or any type of complication, they will not accept. In our medical purpose, nothing called by a complication, all are medical negligency. So we are very much cautious about our treatment protocol, otherwise we can get cases. So in case of benign bone tumor like unicameral bone cyst, now it is treated with a very minimum invasive brain slaying technique. It will heal spontaneously without any further morbidity. Unicameral bone cyst supposed to be retention cyst and just below the physis, and if we do a nailing through this tumor, and that retention fluid will be dissolved by draining the fluid into the medullary cavity of the bone. But this operation must be done in a proximal femur, like or proximal tibia in weight bearing zone. Otherwise, suppose this bone tumor is affecting our proximal humerus, no need to do this operation. Only hanging cast is or any stabilization and serial except follow up may be help in our long term treatment. But in case of proximal femur, when we are getting this impending pathological fracture or pathological fracture after the radio clinical radiological diagnosis, we can do this nailing, and after 6 months when it will heal, we'll remove this, and this tense nail helps in periodic age. Why? Because we can put intermedullary under siam overage, we can spare the physis easily, because the pediatric age group, if we damage the physis, there will be a complication like limb discrepancy. But tens will by tens we can avoid this. Now anonymous bone cyst, anonymous bone cyst is recently treated by sclerotherapy only. Means if suppose this is anonymous bone cyst, we can put a needle and we will just scrape the all material out, and we will put pedocanal one sclerotherapy, which is used in so anonymous bone cyst can be managed without any invasive procedure, big invasive procedure. We can do it by percutaneous method, which is called sclerotherapy, and whole procedure is called curoscopy. Now this is the example of bone needle curettage and suction out of the epithelial tissue in cavity filled up with pedocanal. aseptic and it will cause aseptic inflammation, which helps aid spontaneous healing of that tumor. And in this is in the example of proximal tibia, where multiple angle accurately after the sclerotherapy, the bone is remodeled as a normal bone. And this is the example of axial skeletal, like pubic ischial bone, and after sclerotherapy, the good sclerosis of the bone occur without any recurrence. And now, this is in the new development of osteoma treatment. In the old teaching, we used to treat this osteoma. It is a hyperperiostosis in a cortex, and there will be needles which can see in the CT scan, axial CT scan. And most common site is proximal femur, then the tibia. And for this type of tumor, old teaching, we used to go for wide excision of the small nidus, but that can be done by open procedure, and that can hamper the stability of the bone, that can cause stress fracture in the long run. And along with the incision line morbidity, anesthesia morbidity, long hospital stay, that's all. But if we go the percutaneous technique, this is called CT guided radio frequency elevation, and this is the procedure where patient leg and will examine under CT scan, and through CT scan we can mapping the nidus, and we will put our cone needle over this targeted area. We have to make a drill. After that, we will put the guide wire along with a small tube, and after that, that tube will pass a probe, a radio frequency probe will pass through this small tube, and it will be targeted on the nidus. After this time, this whole system will be stabilized, and patient will be under anesthesia or mild sedation. So it will increase the temperature up to 90 degree, and it will burn the nidus. And after this, we just put a small incision over the percutaneous skin incision, and patient can get immediate pain relief and very less morbidity. Can that can be done in a daycare procedure, and patient can allow for immediate weight bearing. So this is a marvelous approach for a case of osteoma, and the procedure is called CT guided percutaneous CT guided radio frequency elevation. Now another technique is also this technique also done in treatment of chondroblastoma. Chondroblastoma is a benign tumor. It's a chondroblastic tumor, most commonly found in the epiphyseal region in the growing age group, and may be also found in the mature bone. See, this is a oscillating lesion over the femoral head and orbital bone. This is a CT scan, axial CT scan, and this is the coronal cut, and we can see the oscillating lesion and small calcification. And same thing in proximal tibia, and just involve the subarticular region. This type of case, if we do if we go for open biopsy or curettage, and then the problem will, the joint will be contaminated, and there will be stiffness, and there is a chance of avascular necrosis in case of bone, and there is a chance of knee stiffness over this knee joint. So better go for a very minimal invasive technique like CT guided radio frequency elevation. This technique can help to get out of this the problem of open operation, and that will be reduced, or the or that wound that tumor will be healed up by normal calcification. Now our giant cell tumor has a high propensity for recurrence. I taught you in the giant cell tumor class that the main backlog of giant cell tumor is its recurrence. Why? Because when we are treating a case of giant cell tumor, we will approach intranasally. Intranasally means we will enter the tumor through a window, and we will curate this tumor or excise out that tumor through the tumor. So this is intranasal curettage. During this procedure, sometimes suppose we are using this curette, but small tumor cell can be hided. What? The irregular harvest of the bone. So that will cause the recurrence in the long term. So we are going to use the high speed bar. This high speed bar helps to mop up all the residual tumor. So this high speed bar is mandatory for any GCT curettage. And after this curettage, we can in the old teaching we just filled up the void, but nowadays we are using a plate over this bony defect along with in the weight bearing joint like knee joint. It will help for allowing early weight bearing and good knee movement, as well as it will we use to give joledronic acid over the bed of the tumor. It will help in long run for a good healing, and it also prevent the recurrence. So intranasal joledronic acid and locking plate utilization, high speed bar, along with we have to use the endoscopic light sources, the laryngeal mirror and pulsatile lavage is the latest armamentarium for treatment of giant cell tumor. If we treat the giant cell tumor like this, the chance of recurrent giant cell tumor is very low, and if we can allow the patient for early immobility, and it will give a very good clinical outcome. Now regarding the axial tumor, like in the tumor in the sacrum, like the tumor in the cervical spine, how you go for excision, how you go for curettage? This is very important structure, like foramen transversarium. This is the foramen magna and central canal. And regarding the sacrum, this is the sacrala, there is a big vessels and nerve. It's not possible to going to operate this highly vascular and highly neurotized area. So better go for arterial embolization along with the joledronic acid, which is very effective for unapproachable area like interpelvis or spinal tumor. Like this city, you can treat this like this. Now a magic drug is called denosumab. This denosumab first used in osteoporosis, but nowadays it is in our bone tumor. And now what is the use of denosumab? It can cause decrease the activity of osteoclast, and it forms a very good cell over and the surrounding of the tumor, and it helps to make a inoperable case to operable case. And sometimes when see this was a preoperative giant cell tumor case affecting the proximal humerus, after this denosumab, which is brand name is Jiva, we can look at the calcification. After that, we can go for curettage, and we will put a spacer like Ender's nail and bone cement. So the function of the proximal humerus has been preserved along with the limb salvage. Same thing, if this is maximum involvement, we can excise out, and we can give a spacer only like a K-nail, and we will put a small polyene mesh with this K-nail along with the clavicle or the glenoid cavity. It will act as a false shoulder joint. So the normal function except abduction will occur the shoulder joint. Now the recent update for malignant bone tumor. For the malignant bone tumor, amputation has been a standard method of choice, but nowadays limb salvage surgery is recommended as far as possible as a routine and up to 90% of the patient with extremity malignant bone tumor. Amputation is the life-saving operation in malignant bone tumor, but not the best where we can save the limb. Now, definition of limb salvage surgery. It is a set of surgical techniques that have been developed to restore the skeletal continuity following the end block dissection of the bone and soft tissue neoplasm. And our goal is to give a painless limb and functional tumor-free life, because the recurrence of the malignant bone tumor is very high. So if we can give a functional limb and without recurrence, that will be better than a prosthetic limb. Now there is a small principle or very important principle during the resection. The resection, we have to follow Kawaguchi concept. He is an orthopedic surgeon. Mostly he is dealing with the bone and soft tissue tumor. For whole life he dedicated his whole work for wide dissection of the tumor. He told us that our normal tissue has a special resistance to prevent the tumor invasion. Now this type of resistance will help to make a relative barrier or relative distance from the tumor tissue. Means, as a rule, from the malignant tumor you have to go at least 2 to 3 centimeter above. So 2 to 3 centimeter free healthy muscle or bone or healthy tissue is mandatory to told it as a wide resection. If we go through the tumor and if we will excise the tumor, is called interlesional excision. Like bone tumor, if we go through this, this is called interlesional excision. If we cut this bone through 1 to 2 centimeter above, this is called marginal resection. But if we will go 2 to 3 centimeter above the tumor or 2 to 3 centimeter above the muscle, this is called wide resection. And what is called radical resection? Radical resection, whole muscle along with the bone will be set. Like in this case, the whole tumor will be dissected. When, what is the indication of radical resection? If suppose there is a metastasis of over the LT, then how you will cut here, this is not possible for skeletal continuity. This dissection is not acceptable, so you have to cut the whole femur. It's called radical dissection. But if the tumor is confined to this area, we can cut this. This is called wide dissection. Now there is two things: one is bone or one is soft tissue. There is no hard and fast rule that the bone tumor only involve the bone, and there is no hard and fast rule the soft tumor only involve soft tumor soft tissue or muscles. It can involve the bone also. Now our the physiological barrier has been classified 2 to 3 types, and we have our goal is to get a tumor free margin, and the required length is 2 to 3 centimeter from the bone tumor. Now just imagine if we get a healthy normal tissue like
joint cartilage, like physis in the pediatric age group. It is equivalent that we are 5 centimeter far away from the tumor. What my point? Suppose the tumor is not affecting the physis, and if we cut this bone through the physis or just above the physis, so epiphysis can be retained, so joint can be retained. So we are very close to the tumor, but virtually as the joint cartilage or physis is not involved, so virtually we are 5 centimeter away from the bone tumor. Got my point? Now this is called thick barrier, and in normal adult thick barrier is equivalent to 3 centimeter of the free margin. Another example is joint capsule, deep fascia, healthy tendon, healthy muscle. They are equivalent to 3 centimeter of thick margin. But always we cannot get 3 centimeter free margin because the nerve and vessel is very important thing. So in that case, if we can get a free superficial fascia or free fascia or free epineurium or free vascular sheath, free vascular sheath means the tumor not invade this vascular sheath. If vascular sheath is involved, then we cannot get this margin. So we have to sacrifice that vessels. But if vascular sheath is not involved, then we are virtually minimum 2 centimeter away from the bone tumor. So this is the barrier concept. And the preoperative calculation of this margin has been highly developed by MRI. MRI T1 image is very important to know the intraosseous distance or extraosseous involvement, etc. And T1 image has been documented preoperatively. Now there is a 3-strike rule: bone, nerve, and vessels. And last is soft tissue envelope. Among these 4, at least 3 must be intact. Like if 3 of these key components are involved in the limb salvage, is probably not worthy to consider. Means suppose bone is involved, okay, but nerve is not involved, main nerve is not involved, but vessel is involved, but we can get good soft tissue envelope. So nerve, bone, among the nerve and bone, I just want to share one thing. If the main functioning nerve of a limb is involved, this is a contraindication for limb salvage. But sometimes if suppose one segment of the vessel is involved, this is not a contraindication for the limb salvage. We can recreate or we can repair this segment of the vessels by the graft, like saponous graft or artificial xerotrace graft. That's all. But more than 3 is involved or major nerve is involved, then limb salvage should not do. Because after this limb salvage, if or Y dissection, there will be no functional limb. So that will be better that will be better for sacrifice the limb and give a proper prosthesis and early mobilization of the patient. And if we get a defect, we can reconstruct it with a mega prosthesis. Now regarding the treatment plan, we have already discussed after staging we have to go for preoperative neoadjuvant chemotherapy, then we have go for operation limb salvage surgery, and after that we have to give adjuvant chemotherapy.
And regarding the metastasis, sometimes we all know that metastasis is the end. But if it is multiple bony mets, if it is multiple bilateral lung involvement, it is multiple lymph node involvement, it is a contraindication. But it is a relative contraindication nowadays because we have developed our clinical operative skill like gonad, ligament. Lymph node dissection. Lymph node dissection means if we get involved the lymph node of inguinal region or some area basin, draining basin will be involved. We can go for proper lymph node dissection. If we go for proper lymph node dissection, so lymph can be salvageable. Again, regarding the metastasis of the lung, if there is bilateral lung metastasis, then it is a contraindication. But if it is unilateral lung metastasis and more than one, less than 2 to 3 involvement, we can operate, and this metastasis is called metastatectomy, and no need to open the thoracic cavity. We can do a video assisted thoracic surgery, or it is called VATS. So after the limb salvage surgery, the current reconstruction option are endoprosthesis, then allograft prosthesis, then biological reconstruction. This biological is reconstruction by fibula or any other means is best reconstruction worldwide. But the allograft need a bone bank support, and the endoprosthesis has its cost, very high cost, and it has a own problem of infection, and operative procedure is very tricky part of this reconstruction. And this endoprosthesis has, after 10 years it will fail because in wear and tear. So best is biological reconstruction. Now there are some example of limb salvage surgery. This gentleman was present with proximal femoral osteolysis. After biopsy, we see this is a pleomorphic sarcoma. We have done a proximal femoral dissection. We have then applied the bipolar prosthesis. The hip capsule is repaired by the proline mesh, and this is the post op, and patient can do early weight bearing. This is the treatment by prosthesis. Now in pediatric age group, there is a issue of lymph node discrepancy. We can use expandable megaprosthesis, which is very very costly, but we can done by MRI magnetography and electromagnetic field. We can increase the length of these prosthesis yearly, so there will be no lymph node discrepancy for in child. Now another best method for biological reconstruction is extracorporeal radiation of the bone, and use the self tumor bone after killing the tumor tissue by radiation or liquid nitrogen or pasteurization. Means we have to cut the tumor. We put this tumor in liquid nitrogen, or we send it to radiation therapy unit with a sterile package with and they will give 60 gray radiotherapy for 30 minutes. That will kill the whole bone. Same thing in liquid nitrogen. If we dip it into the liquid nitrogen, it will stay for 25 minutes, and the temperature of liquid nitrogen is minus 180 degree, and it will kill the bacteria. Kill the tumor. And same thing is pasteurization. We can increase the temperature, and it will put for 30 minutes in a sterile autoclave machine, and we'll put it back to the patient. And that graft will be act like a custom-made size match graft. So there is no issue of the sizing or in limited indiscriminacy. Issue is when we are reusing this bone, the union is the problem. So best is for pedicle cryotherapy, means there will be one osteotomy, but this part will not do any osteotomy. So blood supply from this will be remain intact, and we will dip it into the liquid nitrogen, we'll put it back. So this is called pedicle cryotherapy. This is better than this radiation. See, there is an example where the ulna has a tumor. We cut it and we excise the tumor mass and we send it to the radiation therapy 60 years for 30 minutes. Then it came it back and we will put this in this proximal ulna. We will put a plate and we will do a small reconstruction with Pomeranian longus graft and see the function. So it is the magical effect of extracorporeal radiation. And last but not the least is rotationplasty. Is the best biological durable alternative for all bone tumor in malignant bone tumor in case of pediatric age group, where is the limited discrepancy and growing child, where the process is very highly cost effective. But if we go for rotation of this limb and along with dissection of the tumor and maintaining the continuity of vessel and nerve, we can get a good function after proper treating. This is called rotationplasty. After rotationplasty, patient can do anything like jumping, playing basketball, belly dance, anything can do after a proper operation and proper physiotherapy. Last but not the least is immunotherapy. It is come in the market. The immunotherapy has immense role based on dendritic cell therapy. Latest drug is Hasrenib, used in soft tissue sarcoma. And the involvement, the improvement of operative procedure in orthopedic surgery has a immense beneficial for our end stage disease or newcomers patient. And this is all total about the recent advancement of the bone tumor. And this process is called ice cream cone process, used after the pelvic dissection. This is the proximal femur megaprosthesis with total hip replacement, and the stem is put into the iliac bone. This is called ice cream cone process. So it is also called internal extra articular hip wide dissection. Means the joint of the hip joint along with proximal femur has been dissected out for a malignant tumor. But this patient can enjoy his life with these processes. Thank you.